Craig, in Deloitte's latest economic outlook, it suggests that Canada's recovery is going to lose momentum. What do you attribute that to?
So what we've seen in the Canadian economy is after an enormous contraction in March and April, when the economy reopened starting in May, in the following months, we've had a remarkable rebound in activity. Now, some of that was, of course, expected because, you know, basically reopening non-essential businesses was bound to create a real resurgence in economic growth. But if anything, the rebound has been much more pronounced than economists were anticipating. In particular, retail sales have actually returned to their pre-COVID levels in July. And real estate markets across the country are delivering considerable strength at a time when unemployment has increased. And so on the domestic front, both in terms of the consumer and real estate, we're ending up with a stronger rebound in activity. But when we look ahead, the pace of growth is bound to slow. And the reason for this is, first of all, the reopening effect is now behind us. And then as we look forward, we're likely to see more of the economic scarring that occurred start to materialize. So for example, as Canadian workers are transferred off of the $500 a week Canadian Emergency Response Benefit onto an enlarged EI program, Employment Insurance Program, or one of the other programs the government set up, the income support is going to diminish. And I think at that point, you're going to start to see a bit more of the economic harm that's been done to the Canadian labor market. So the recovery is expected to continue, but it's likely to do so at a slower pace. And the other dimension, of course, is that with the reopening, as the kids go back to school, as we're in cooler weather, we are seeing infection rates rising across the country. And so I think that with the health risks persisting until we have a vaccine, again, after that initial reopening effect, we're probably going to see the pace of economic recovery slow.
Does the throne speech change any of the analysis in the report?
Well, there was a couple of explicit things in the throne speech, which, if anything, it creates a bit more of a positive outlook. One of the key measures was the fact that the government extended the business wage subsidy until next summer. And so, you know, when I talked about the income support programs gradually being scaled back, you know, we're going to see that on the front of individual workers. But in terms of the business subsidy or business wage subsidy, which is actually what the government's attempting to do is to incent businesses to hire workers and reduce the unemployment, and at the same time support the income of unemployed workers, but not have a disincentive to work. And I think that's why they're phasing out the CERB, but at the same time extending the wage subsidy. And on balance, I think that's the right approach.
Your overall impressions of the speech?
Well, the throne speech was very ambitious. If I think the priorities were the right ones in the sense of, first and foremost, the job number one from a government point of view is to address the health risks. And you know, the message that the federal government is going to help provinces with testing is absolutely right. When we look at other jurisdictions that have managed the health risks better, we know that testing and monitoring is critical. In terms of maintaining income support to workers, particularly you know unemployed workers, the fact that the government is still maintaining support even though it's getting you know scaled back is again is positive. One of the big announcements was the commitment to make large scale significant long-term investment in early learning and childcare. And, you know, that to me actually has considerable merit in that if you provide more affordable, accessible childcare, it will help women who have been disproportionately impacted by this downturn come back into the labor market. But at the same time, if you invest in early learning, you can have that childcare actually provide additional skills and create more resilient young people and make children better ready to enter the school system. So I think it's a combination of a good short-term measure and positive from a longer-term point of view. The government mentioned increased investments in infrastructure, particularly in areas like broadband and digital. There was a comment around basically IT investment for government. And quite frankly, when we think about which sectors of the Canadian economy were actually capable of dealing with the shift to more remote work and more digital delivery, You know, areas like financial services was very well prepared for this, but government was one of the sectors worst prepared for this. And so I actually think that creating a more digital government is actually a positive thing that could create some gains in terms of productivity. I think that, you know, there's an enormous number of measures that in the throne speech, it was incredibly long, and it's because there was so many announcements to be had in it. But, you know, in effect, what it was a budget without dollars. And that's the main criticism. The main issue is that a throne speech isn't supposed to give you the financial numbers, but, you know, the government outlined an enormously ambitious agenda. And the real question that economists and financial markets are going to have is, how are you going to pay for this? And so one of the things that was in the throne speech was a commitment that there will be a fall fiscal update. And I am waiting with bated breath to find out what the government's going to do. Because when I looked at the measures, I thought, you know, individually look at the measures, a lot of them, I said, yep, that makes a lot of sense. But my immediate thought is, how much is that going to cost and how are you going to afford it?
I want to go back to something that you had mentioned with respect to businesses and whether or not the wage subsidy program is enough to bridge the gap for these businesses to survive or to continue here in Canada. What are you hearing?
So from a business community point of view, I think that the news of the extension of the wage subsidy is absolutely a positive announcement. For those businesses that are having a really hard time to recover, I think that was welcome news. One of the other things that they mentioned in the budget was that there will be additional funding for particularly hard-hit industries. So when we look at the economic recovery, and in terms of my forecast, what we can see is the industry picture is very uneven. So if you look at things like air transportation, you know, it dropped 95% and really hasn't shown much in the way of recovery. When you think about travel, tourism, hospitality, you know, there's a lot of sectors that have really suffered here and are going to need additional help. And so there was commentary in the throne speech that there will be help for those sectors. And when I talk to business owners or business leaders in those areas, you know, those hardest hit sectors are still not, you know, they're only seeing limited benefits to the economic recovery. While many other sectors have been thriving. Like, so again, I go back to retail, where you've had an enormous rebound in retail spending. But one of the things that's happened is the composition of spending has changed dramatically. So, you know, even within sectors, you can't even say, you know, that retail's done well, because it's, you know, some retail segments have done great and other segments are still deeply underwater. So the government in the throne speech mentioned enhancing or improving the business access to credit program. And I think that is meritworthy for businesses that are struggling. And when we think about it for the hard hit industries, I do think that a lot of the hardest hit industries are still going to need some help, particularly sort of transforming themselves or adjusting to the new economic reality, because, you know, it's not clear exactly when we're going to get a vaccine and when it's going to be deployed. So the health risks are going to persist. So, you know, when I talk to businesses, one of the things I'm most impressed by is that many business leaders, you know, and executive teams are looking at all options. And so what you have is a situation where in response to the crisis, they've had to do things like figure out how to do remote work and more digital delivery. But because they're making big changes to their business model, they're actually willing to have conversations about even greater and broader changes to their business model. So, you know, I actually think, you know, and, you know, if you know, in a positive, you know, from a positive perspective, I actually think that this could, you know, we could end up with businesses in Canada becoming more resilient and having made, you know, more strategic investments in areas like digital because of the crisis. And I think that's a core message, because I don't think pre-COVID that Canada was on the path of prosperity. I think we were in a world of slowing trend economic growth, and I fundamentally believe we need a growth agenda to create more prosperity post-COVID and also allow governments to basically rebalance their books after the enormous amount of debt they're taking on.
It's an unprecedented time in U.S. politics with this question of a peaceful transition up in the air. How does that impact Canadian businesses?
Well, this is a question I get all the time from during business presentations. So clearly there's a lot of anxiety in Canada about about the outlook for the U.S., and there is a very strong political dimension here. So in addition to the, you know, the question of the election itself, one of the big challenges we have is that while Canada is only gradually and incrementally reducing the government income supports, emergency income support programs, in the U.S., they are coming to a close, and Congress has not been able to agree on additional fiscal stimulus or fiscal measures. And so there's a lot of concern on the part of economic forecasters like myself that if Congress can't act, that you're going to see the U.S. recovery slow quite sharply. The second dimension here is that if we look over the last, you know, since the start of this year, if we look at the health outcomes, Canada versus U.S., it does look like the U.S. has had a more difficult time dealing with the health risks. And of course, with the cold weather and kids going back to school, we're seeing higher infection rates in Canada, in the U.S. Now, the issue here is even if Canada manages the health risks, if the U.S. doesn't, it will really hurt the Canadian economy because of our trade dependence with the U.S. Many of our businesses are integrated into North American supply chains. So if the U.S. recovery loses momentum, this would be a big concern. And then with respect to politics, I mean, one of the challenges we face is that we're going to have a presidential, you know, we're going to have a U.S. election in November, but we might not know actually the outcome of that election for quite some time, because you might have a very high proportion of votes being mailed in. So on election night, you might actually not know what the true tally of votes are. And, you know, the fact that this could create an environment where, you know, in the worst case scenario, you would have a situation where somebody declares victory on November 3rd. And then, you know, in subsequent weeks, you find out that when all the votes were tallied, somebody else won. And this could actually create a lot of uncertainty. And, you know, from a financial market point of view, we know markets hate uncertainty. And the reality is, you know, I think there's a material risk that we won't know the outcome of the U.S. election immediately. And so, you know, any sort of political instability in the U.S. creates, you know, economic risks to the U.S. economy, but that then, indirectly leads to increased economic risks for Canada.